assistance, and then they'll move on to the exchange or have the middle class subsidy. And
all that work.
So I come do some of my videos.
In 800 feet, exit to I-495 East Beltway, Baltimore.
What's up, everyone? This is Ryan Hildreth. I'm sure most of you are in Tide's social media marketing agency program. If not, you're just a fellow YouTuber, entrepreneur. But today I wanted to talk about my experience in Tide's program. It's good to get a perspective from someone who's maybe done it before or is going through the same things you're going through. So that's why I wanted to start making these vlogs for you, just to give you insight of like what I'm going through building my agency from, you know, zero to hopefully six figures by the end of the year. That's my goal. I just wanted to give you some insight on what I've been experiencing so far. So I started the program in December. And I think around the 35 video mark, I decided I was going to go approach some businesses. But as you know, Ty's uploading new videos every month, so there's more and more to come. But I got enough confidence to where I was like, you know what, I'm going to build my website.
Exit right to I-495 East Beltway, Baltimore.
LegalZoom, which I did. And, just maybe apply some of these tactics to my own personal social media, which I recommend you do because it's good to have, you know, prior experience before approaching your first client. You've got to show up prepared. So for me, I'm very responsible. I like to back up my word. So when I'm approaching businesses and I'm telling them, you know, I'm going to run your Facebook advertising, I'm going to get you thousands of followers, I'm going to, you know, build great content for you and to increase your revenue and generate more sales. Well, I want to be able to say those things, not only because I have the certificate from Ty, but because I've applied these same concepts into my own personal social media. You know, when you go to these businesses, which you will, maybe you're probably already doing, or maybe you already have your first client, but it's good to, for the long term perspective, if you want these clients long term and they look up who you are and they see, oh, you know, Joe Schmo has two followers on Instagram, yet he's managing our Instagram and our Facebook and running our advertisements, and his own personal Instagram or maybe his, you know, agency Instagram has, you know, two followers. What are they going to think of your agency when they see that? So maybe in the short term you can get these clients quick, but in the long term they're not going to be able to stay with you if you can't represent yourself in a professional way because you are providing.
Estimated time in traffic, 7 minutes.
So
continue straight for 8 minutes to exit 27, I-95 North, Baltimore.
You know, I went to Pexels.com. They have great stock photos that you can use. I'll put all the links to, my personal Instagram, my website, and some resources you can use to build your website and maybe help your clients out. But I use Pexels because they have free stock photos, which are, you know, no copyrights, and they're beautiful images, so I recommend using those. So I built my website, made it mobile friendly. It's beautiful and people could, you know, understand what I do by going there. And also what's nice is too is I put a pop-up so with a free business audit, so I could collect some emails and do free business audits for people that visit my website. So go check that out. I put the link in the description below. But yeah, so I made all my four revenue media. I made the Instagram page, the Facebook page, LinkedIn page, which is very important so that on your LinkedIn, when it says, you know, where you work or what business you own, you can have your nice company logo right there as well. So I suggest going on LinkedIn and creating your company page. And also, LinkedIn is a great place to get referrals or network with owners of small businesses. So I did all that. I even built my personal Instagram, my following. I built that up, reached out to hundreds of people, you know, just providing value. So what I do on the side is I actually trade options and I invest in the stock market. So that's my primary source of income. But I wanted to do this social media project, you know, creating an agency and building that up because I feel like it's going to help my trading business as well and promoting that online. So yeah, I did all that. Then I went out, I did my business audits. I just was looking around. I used the Yelp advertising tool that Joe Soto showed, and I saw that a lot of the dry cleaning services in the area were utilizing Yelp, but they didn't have a website, they didn't have Instagram, Facebook, any Twitter, nothing. So I was like, you know what, I'm gonna just go for dry cleaning services. So I approached 6 dry cleaning services, and I saw a common theme. Every time I went in there, I noticed that, you know, the place looked like crap. They didn't keep their company, you know, their storefront looking nice. So I was a little turned off by that because I don't want to work with clients that don't even support their own business. They can't even keep it clean for their customers. Remember, you're going to be driving thousands of customers to these forefronts, and you don't want to represent a company that doesn't care about the customer or the client. So I noticed that a lot of the dry cleaning services aren't really professional on that front. So, but I did encounter one that was, you know, great. They had granite countertops, you know, super nice, and they had the budget to go with my services. So that's another thing. You gotta pick a niche that, you know, will have the budget to pay for your services, because if you choose a niche that maybe they're, you know, tight on cash, they're gonna be complaining to you. They're not gonna be good long-term customers. So I approached 6 dry cleaners. Out of the 6, there was one that actually had the budget and was a beautiful place that I wanted to represent, but I'm still working things out with the owner. You know, the owner's super busy, and they're currently locked into a contract with an SEO company. So, you know, things are going okay with them. I'm keeping in contact with the owner, but I'm focusing on going towards a different niche. So then I decided, you know what, I'm not going to focus on one niche only. I'm just going to hit up every business in the area and just kind of feel it out, because I want to see if their storefront's nice, if they're going to have the budget, if the owner's available. That's probably the hardest thing I've encountered, was getting in touch with the owner. So today I went to a jeweler in the area, which was a beautiful place, nice storefront. The owner was there, which was great.
Watch out, vehicle stopped on shoulder ahead.
I'm going to be doing his website and working with him a little bit. So hopefully we can sign a contract for the advertisements. But as far as that goes, like, really just hitting up every avenue and just consistency. I think, like, waking up in the morning, sometimes I'm feeling unmotivated or a little nervous to approach businesses, but, like, as long as you have the consistency.
Welcome to My I Like You, the best way to automatically track your drives. Today, we're going to show you how to classify a ride. Once you've taken a drive, the drive card will show up in your My I Like You feed. You'll see the start and end location, the number of miles, and the potential dollars that it's worth. The primary classifications for a drive are business and personal. To classify a drive, it's just one swipe. You swipe right for business and left for personal. To add more details to the drive, you can swipe and hold. You'll see it says add a purpose, and we can say customer visit. We can do the same for personal. So if you swipe left and hold, say charity expenses. Once you've classified all of your rides, you can send yourself a report. And you're all done. More to come later from Mile IQ.
Consistency, and you're going out there and just approaching, because you're not going to get 100% close rate. That's just not how it happens. And if it does, it might not be long term, or it might just be beginner's luck. So, I mean, if you could pull anything from this video, I'll be updating you guys every week. But if you could pull anything from this video, is to, like, make sure your personal branding is good. So, like, your own Instagram page, your own stuff, because if they search you and, you know, you're very unprofessional, or you have, like, 2 followers and you want to run their marketing campaigns, you know, that's not going to look very good. They might not stick with you if you do gain a client. So, yeah, personal branding, make sure your stuff is in check. utilizing these tactics that Ty is teaching us to build your own brand. Number two is, you know, make sure to have your website up. You know, make sure your website's mobile friendly, looking good, so that your clients are gonna, your prospective clients are gonna be like, wow, this is a nice website. He could probably build ours this way. You know, you want them to like want what you have. So if that's the best way of putting it. So yeah, definitely utilizing your personal brand and utilizing you know, a nice website for your agency. And then the third would probably be just take action. Just keep approaching new small businesses. There's bound to be one out there that is, you know, fit for you. I still haven't found, you know, signed a contract yet, but I am working with a jeweler right now to optimize his website so that I can lead him into, you know, my marketing services and my advertising services, which we can leverage his website on. But, you know, I'm just going to take you through my journey. I have zero clients so far, so I will update you every week on how it's going. This is my first week of approaching businesses, and it's been great. I've approached seven so far, and out of the seven, two of them, you know, I'm in contact with the owner, and we're working on some things. So,
what's your favorite book and why?
Okay, so I don't know my favorite book, but I am reading a book called Tampa right now, and I read a book. One of my favorite books was The Child Called It.
Okay.
It was so emotional. It really was like graphic, and it was deep, and it brought you into a world of a child that had hard to believe, but it was a true story.
Yeah. Oh, one other question. Mentor.
What should I read? That's what you should be telling me. Since you know.
Headed to the World Series. Taking the Challenger jet. I was doing the Rob Report car judging, so I had to take this so we can get there in 4.5 hours. In the car, I was listening to some Rihanna songs, and it reminded me of something. It reminded me of how impressed I was with Rihanna when I met her.
One of the impressive things about Rihanna to me was that, you know, she's one of the most popular people in the world. If anybody could be cocky, you know, and not be interested in other people, it'd be her. But the first thing, if you see my interview with her, that she said to me, I started out and I said, Rihanna, you know, what's your favorite book? And she started to talk, and then she caught herself and said, wait a sec, Ty, you're the book guy. What's your favorite book? And you see, I can't tell you how many people who have accomplished less than Rihanna, okay, are so much cockier than her. See, that question is a sign of true humility. When you realize you don't have all the answers and that someone else does, and that you also, in the 67 steps, I talk about how you have to know who's in the
I think Drake.
And the Grammy goes to.
Let's see if I'm right.
Chance the Rapper!
Oh! Chance! Damn!
We are headed to the Grammys, taking my mom, Noelle, and Rome somewhere out here. We're gonna take the rolls.
In 1.8 miles, turn right on Evans Trail.
Love it. You're
There's so much to smell.
Yeah, you probably need two Jeremy Shepherds and one small dog.
Inside, though, I was thinking of getting a wiener dog. Those things make me laugh.
Those are cool.
Just when they walk around, I literally make me happy just to see their, like, fun bodies.
Judges with Don Cheadle for the 2017 Rob Report luxury car, so I'm going to be driving all kinds of cool cars. I think I've got it.
Starting route to Van Nuys Airport.
Taking the little jet.
Kardashian land. There's Paul's over there, too.
You don't want to get good at spending and consuming stuff. You want to know how to do it, but it shouldn't be your, it's not a life objective. It's more like having to go to the bathroom, having to pee. You have to pee. Speaking of that, did Zach just go back there in the bathroom? The Rob Report 2017 luxury car thing here, taking the little jet. And one thing that I was gonna, when my second mentor, Alan Nation, you can close and open the Rolls Royce Dawn while you're going 25, I'm going 25 miles an hour, up to 30 miles an hour. That's a dope feature. Check that out. There we go, we're closed up. Boom.
Let's hear how this engine sounds. Got that core sound to it. Like the GPS is built right into the dash, which is kind of nice. I flew in to the Rob, one of the Rob Report 2017 car and driver, their report they're doing. I'm checking out all the new cars I'm gonna be driving tomorrow. Porsche 911 Turbo 2017.
If you want to make real money, you're going to have to be in possession of one certain skill. And it's not the simplest skill. It's the simplest to understand, but it's not the simplest to pull off. So I just took a little break here, walked out on my porch here at my home office. And I was thinking, because it's on my mind, as I grow the different businesses that I have, or the businesses that we invest in, I think almost daily, man, I wish I could be better at this. And that one skill is the ability to pass your skills on to other people. So if you can't do this, which most people can never do, you will never get your nose away from the grind. You'll never be able to step back and look at the big picture. You'll be too busy running errands and, you know, running accounting and whatever it is. And you probably feel this in life. I think every entrepreneur at any level. I was just having lunch with two entrepreneurs here that are some of the most successful guys in the world. It's at Burbank, having lunch with them. They're talking guys making a tremendous amount of money a month. And you can see that if they could snap their fingers
in 1,000 feet, turn right.
They would be like, how could we duplicate ourselves? How could we clone ourselves? And so you got to take these big picture things. And even if you're not in business, you can still feel this. If you have kids, if you, you know, have a job, just a 9-to-5.
Turn right on Evans Trail.
If there was just one more of me, everything would change. But imagine if there was two more of you or three more of you.
In 900 feet, you'll arrive at Jiref.
Passed on what you know to them. Imagine, and again, you can do this for unselfish reasons. Your goal could be to save the world, help the world. And people do this with their kids.
You've arrived at your destination.
I think, wouldn't feel they'd... least if you look out in the world, most people aren't doing a good job of passing this on to their kids. Teachers in the modern education system want and certainly try, but I would say that we live in a world, 7.3 billion people.